Danny, again, thank you for inviting me. It's really a nice meeting. I always felt a bit lost in my bacillus field because almost nobody was working on lipids and membranes. And finally, you know, the field is becoming more mature. So I'm very happy to hear all these lipid talks. Okay, so this will be about, almost all this work has been done primarily by one fantastic postdoc, Michele Wenzel, that Henrik already mentioned, and she's shown there. And this is a blow-up picture of her beautiful girl. This is the first slide. And I always get a bit fed up with, you know, so I'm not going to bother you with the rise in multidrug resistance and all these graphs where, you know, so it's going really pear-shaped. Because my feeling over the years is that actually we have more than enough novel antimicrobials. You know, I think there's every week there's a new antimicrobial compound identified. The problem is we don't continue to investigate them. You know, we don't, most of the antimicrobials, we don't actually know very well how they work, the mode of action. And if we don't know exactly how an antibiotic works, of an antimicrobial compound that can become an antibiotic, then we cannot optimize it. You have to realize that almost all antibiotics that we use these days, they have been modified, you know, chemically modified to prevent resistance or to prevent all kind of lethal effects. Yeah. So, but if you want to do that, then you have to know how it works. And I think we should put much more effort into describing a function of new antimicrobial compounds. And one of the tools that we have developed over the years is based on bacterial cell biology. So this was actually done work that Henrik did in when he just came to me as a postdoc. And he was looking at the localization of one of the cell division proteins, MIND. And we found that, that in fact, if you depolarize the cell membrane, you get an immediate delocalization of MIND, as you see here. And he showed later that this was caused by the detachment of the protein because MIND is using a C-terminal antibiotic helix to bind to the membrane, and this binding is stimulated by the membrane potential. Very fascinating phenomenon. This is a warning, you know, many people have difficulties having nice membrane stains in bacillus and E. coli and so on. And one of the reasons is that they use polylysin as an attachment of the slide. Polylysin will depolarize your membrane and will give all kinds of artifacts. So just keep it in mind. Don't use polylysin. Just use fresh agarose PETs if you monitor bacteria. Okay, so we found this, but one thing that was really interesting at that time was that there was around the same time, or just before that, there was a paper in PNAS describing a new mode of action of niacin. Niacin is well established antibiotic, and this is a part of the abstract, and it says that the changes and characteristics of deregulation of a filamentous cell envelope protein MBL and the division inhibiting MIND system causes these phenomena. Huh? So they say, and they say that if you have low concentration of niacin, then you get a phenotype that looks like a MIND mutant or an MBL mutant. And we have shown that both MIND and, in fact, also MBL and MRB, the localization of those proteins are very much depending on the presence of a proper membrane potential. So this is just an artifact, this whole paper. The whole reason is that with this concentration of niacin, you depolarize the membrane, and therefore you get delocalization of MIND and MBL and MRB and so on. So I realized that in fact, just looking under the cell and looking what happens with certain proteins, marker proteins, you can very quickly establish what the activity is of a compound. And that is what we call now bacterial cytological profiling. So this is shown here. We showed you the MIND effect. So you have here MIND on the normal conditions, normal localization is totally insensitive for mitomycin C, which causes DNA damage, or rifampicin, which blocks the RNA polymerase. But if you add CCCP or something else that will destabilize the membrane potential, you see that the localization of MIND is immediately gone. It is a question of minutes. And then in the meantime, if you look at the RAC-A GFP localization in cell, nothing happens if you if you have no memory potential. Nothing happens if you have rifampicin, but if you damage the DNA, very quickly you see these RAC-A filaments. Yeah. And if you look at RNA polymerase localization, in an active growing cells, the RNA polymerase is really recruited to a certain kind of foci, the area where the RNA, the ribosome RNA and proteins are transcribed. And then if you add rifampicin, you see that the localization disappears immediately. Yeah, so this is a very powerful technique, and because these phenomena happen in minutes. And if you have, for example, a mixture of antimicrobial compounds from an extract of fungi, you know, you can use these different markers to see what kind of different activities there are in this extract. So we use this now to look at the activity of novel antimicrobials. But in fact, to establish properly, we were not looking at a novel antimicrobials, we were looking at an antibiotic that was already in the clinic, used for several years. It has been discovered in the early 1980s and is now about 10 years on the market. And it is one of the last resort antibiotics against MRSA. And it is a lipid-based antibiotic with an acyl chain, so it will bind to the membrane. So what is interesting is that it is used in the clinic, but people did not know how it worked. So there were basically three theories: that since it attaches to the membrane, it will depolarize the membrane potential. But others have shown that, in fact, it blocks cell wall synthesis. And just before we started, this research paper came out that it, in fact, causes membrane curvature, and therefore it causes a delocalization of cell wall synthetic machinery. And that is shown here. So they treated Bacillus subtilis with a submic concentration of datamycin, and then you see this blobs. This is now now red stain or FM stain. It doesn't really matter. You see this kind of blobs, but you see a curvature occurring. The cell is a little bit bent. And that is also why where you see the localization of this protein, DIFFer-A. And it's, in fact, my group has shown before this that DIFFer-A GFP, the localization, is very specific for membrane curvature. So the argumentation was that if you see the localization this aberrant localization of DIFFer-A GFP there, apparently there's a strong curvature, and that will eventually lead to aberrant recruitment of essential proteins. Well, the problem is, the issue was I have been working on this protein for 8 years before that, and I know that if it binds to something, it should be binding to the negative curvature, and this is positive curvature, so there was something fishy about it. So this is just to show you what we've shown what we've shown for DIFFer-A. So DIFFer-A is a conserved protein that you can find in every gram-positive, but it does not localize, it's not present in the gram-negatives. This is the localization in Bacillus, but you can also, of course, express it as a fusion with GFP and E. coli, and this is what you see. And in both cases, you see that the protein localizes to the cell poles and at the site of cell division. The localization in Bacillus is much stronger here than E. coli, and the difference is the way these bacteria divide. So Bacillus makes a cross wall, and E. coli kind of constricts. And the difference is that this curvature is very strong, and this curvature is weak. So this is an indication that this protein prefers to accumulate at regions with very, very strong negative curvature. Well, we have shown that in E. coli, to express in E. coli, this is the normal wild-type situation, so you get this kind of, a polar cell division site where you get a nice accumulation of DIFFer-A. This is the membrane stain. But now there are mutants in E. coli that can't divide anymore, that can't separate it. So they lack the outer lysins that will separate the cells. And if you cannot separate it, then your cell becomes flat, and that will generate a strong curvature here. Yeah. So if it is true that DIFFer-A has a special affinity for negative curvature, it will accumulate here. If not, then it will just accumulate all over the place. So this is a mutant in E. coli. So you get here a nice round pole, and here you get a flat pole, strong curvature. And now if you look at the localization of DIFFer-A, it's really accumulating at these areas where you have the strongest negative curvature. So this is the best proof, and this is the reason we think that DIFFer-A accumulates at the cell division sites. So it's negative curvature, not positive curvature. as this shape would suggest. But what you also see are these blobs. And this is in fact what Henrik also showed in this presentation. These blobs can occur because you have different lipids, you know, that will stimulate the staining of your probe, or it might be membrane invaginations. And this is the same picture that Henrik showed based on his work. The localization of MRB, you have also here this blobs that you see in a null red stain. And how do you show that it is not invagination, but that it is caused by the accumulation of your membrane dye and increased fluorescence of your membrane dye? Well, you look at the localization of a transmembrane protein and the ATP synthase. So this is the work that Henrik showed, what he did. ATP synthase, now red stain, in the presence of CCCP, that causes a delocalization of MRB, causes this large clusters occurring. But you see there's completely, as shown here, there's completely no overlap. Yeah, so that means that these blobs are not caused by extra membrane material. Otherwise, you know, you would see those blobs as well. So we repeated this experiment with daptomycin, and that is shown here. So this is a normal situation, FM dye, ATP synthase, you know, scattered all over. If you treat with daptomycin, what you see is with FM dye that you at some point get these large blobs. That was also shown in the slide with the fray. But you can also see that the ATP synthase is nicely located. You know, there's no overlap. So these are not membrane invaginations. And these are regions with a different concentration of your membrane dye. Or an increased fluorescence of your membrane dye. So it is not membrane curvature. Well, the most logical explanation is that it's a depolarization. So what we then did is to establish that we expanded on our assay. So we have now a whole set of proteins that show a very specific localization that is related to their function. Cytoplasmic proteins related to DNA integration or segregation, DNA replication and RNA replication, cell wall synthesis, cell division. And what you can do is then treat these cells with your compound, daptomycin in this case, and then look at what happens. And well, there's not much happening here. If there's something happening, it's here. So you see this delocalization of MIN-D and also sort of a little bit of differ-A. But it doesn't go fast, but nevertheless, there's delocalization. So that would suggest that there is an effect on the membrane potential. So to measure that, you can do your standard disk assay. So the fluorescent probe that is incorporated in the cell and driven by the membrane potential, and it will quenches its own fluorescence, and then if you depolarize the cell, then the compound will be released and the fluorescence will increase. And this is the control with gramicidin, which makes it very well established, makes a clear pore in the membrane. So if you add gramicidin, and these cells are loaded with a dye, if you add gramicidin, then bang, the fluorescence goes up. Yeah. Now we use different concentrations of daptomycin, increasing concentrations, and you see that indeed at very high concentrations, the membrane potential is gone. But in fact, this concentration is already lethal. Yeah. And you can see that despite the fact that this is a lethal concentration, the membrane potential is not completely dissipated. And there's something else. This depolarization, if you look at the x-axis, you know, takes about 20 minutes. That is a very long time, and that means that this antibiotic does not function as a pore, because like gramicidin, which makes a pore of a hole, that's a kind of instantaneous process. So there is an effect on the membrane depolarization. But it is gradual, and it is very likely not the reason why daptomycin kills bacteria. So, yeah, we are stuck then with the cell wall biosynthesis, but that was not completely clear how that could be possible. And this is the evidence that they think that it must actually do something with cell wall synthesis. So if you incorporate, if you use radioactive material, precursors to incorporate in DNA, RNA or protein or cell walls, and then you add daptomycin at this point, you see that there's not much happening with RNA synthesis or protein synthesis or DNA synthesis. The strongest effect is the lack of synthesis of new cell wall components. So we were wondering whether it had to do something still with the membrane localization of proteins because of these large blobs. And we were curious whether daptomycin does something with the RIFs. Well, we got a nice introduction about the RIFs, so regions of increased fibrillity. And of course, the name was thought because it contrasts nicely with rafts. So rafts are non-fluid domains, and RIFs are fluid domains. And you can stain them, as Henrik pointed out, with DIC12, which is nicely shown here. It looks like a very short peptide, and it prefers regions with more fluidity. And it co-localizes with MRB. So we stained the cell with DIC12, and it is shown here. And then we treated it with daptomycin. And we also stained our daptomycin, as is shown here. And this is the overlay. So in the beginning, so here you have the RIFs, in the beginning there is not much happening. But over time, you see that large foci of DIC12 end with daptomycin. And if you look carefully, you see that the large foci that you see with DIC12 are also the ones where daptomycin integrates in the membrane first. So it seems to be that daptomycin has a preference for these RIFs, and it also seemed to change the whole organization of the membrane so that these RIFs seem to accumulate at large regions, foci. Overall, what happens to the cell, this is the Laudan general polarization global effect that Henrik showed, is that if you add daptomycin, you get, in fact, indeed, rigidification. And this is the control with benzyl alcohols and alcohol. It makes it more fluid. You see this effect. So overall, you get more rigidification. So if you look at the microscope with Laudan, then this is what you see. So here you have the Laudan GP treated with daptomycin. This is the wild type situation. So you see actually not much difference. But if you look at the FM dye, you can also do the DIC12, it's a little bit the same. You still see these large accumulations of your dye. So these are regions we did with DLC12. So these are regions with a lot of fluid and disordered lipids. But what is surprising is that if you look at the Laudan, these areas are not more fluid. Yeah. So somehow daptomycin will collect these fluid lipids, but will rigidify them as well. So that must have an effect on the localization of membrane proteins. And one of the indications was that we also saw an effect on the delocalization of DIFFER-A, which is really not sensitive for the membrane potential, at least this fusion. So we came up with a theory that is shown here. So here you have your membrane, cytoplasmic and outside, and here you have a RIF, so you have more fluid. This is more fluid with this then are unsaturated fatty acids or short or branched chain fatty acids. And in these regions are often the regions where you find the peripheral membrane proteins that have, for example, an amphipathic helix as an anchor. And the reason is, these bulky anchors can just fit easier into a lipid membrane if the lipids are able to provide some space, so if they are more fluid in that sense. So we think that daptomycin will bind on the outside and prefers to bind at the RIFs. And this creates more disorder, which will accumulate more fluid lipids. And presumably, you get therefore also some flipping. I mean, it's known that it will flip to the other side. And you can imagine that if you have an area with more fluid lipids, the flipping will occur easier. And by this way, it will then delocalize these peripheral membrane proteins like MIND. And how this exactly happens, so it might just prevent the localization, possibility of these proteins to bind there because it occupies these areas, or it might rigidify these fluid lipids as we have shown with the Laudan stain, and therefore it cannot bind. And eventually, you get more clusters. So the Lyman model, but the problem is, what about the membrane depolarization? Well, one of the explanations is that if you have these areas, you saw this large foci, then you get a kind of mismatch between these two areas, the ordered and the disordered areas. And this mismatch is a weak point in the membrane. And it is more easier for ions to diffuse through at this mismatch. So that might explain why you get a slow depolarization. But then we have the problem with the cell envelope synthesis. So how do you explain that? Well, Henrik alluded to that, but there are several. So how do we explain this effect, the strongest effect? Well, there are some proteins that are in fact peripheral membrane proteins and that are very important for the synthesis of the cell wall and of lipids. And one of them is MERG. And this is the GFP fusion of MERG. And what's interesting is that MERG has a perfect co-localization with the DLC12 area, so with RIFs. Now, if you treat these cells with daptomycin within 5 minutes, you see that the delocalization of MERG is complete. So, and that MERG is detached from the membrane. Yeah. So that explains why you cannot have peptidoglycan synthesis anymore, you know, because the lipid-2 precursor is not made in which the MERG is involved. This is not limited to MERG, because the same happens with PSX, and PSX is essential for lipid synthesis. So it shows a comparable pattern as that of MERG. It also co-localizes with DLC12 foci. If you add daptomycin, you get a very rapid delocalization. Yeah. So it turned out that this model is correct. Good. So now, do memory targeting antibodies work the same way? Well, of course not. You know, otherwise, I wouldn't ask those questions. And in fact, Henrik showed that if you have these artificial lipids, they also can do some very funky stuff with membranes. But I also want to show you an example, and that is rhodomere tone. So rhodomere tone is a natural Asian antibiotic that is extracted from this plant. It's a kind of rose. Bottle type of plant, and it is used in Thai traditional medicine. And it's quite active against the gram-positive pathogens. It's not toxic, people think, and like indeed many membrane-targeting antibiotics, there is no resistance yet. But the question is still, how does this work? You know, so based on the structure of this compound, it's not really clear immediately how it works. So we started to do cytological profiling. Well, this is the localization of DNA N, RecA, RPOC, and RPSB. So this is DNA replication, this is DNA repair, this is RNA polymerase, and these are the mitochondria. And then you add rhodomere tone, and you look at any effect on the localization, and we didn't saw much. So the normal processes are not affected. Then we looked at the peripheral membrane proteins. And clearly so, like diframin, D and PSX. This is with a DLC12 stain, the GFP and the MERG stain. There, you saw a strong effect. So if you add rhodomere tone, then you see that the DLC12 goes a completely delocalized stain, so you get large clusters. And the same you see for these peripheral membrane proteins. So a little bit like what we found for daptomycin, but maybe a bit more extreme. But what was really surprising is when we looked at the transmembrane domains, A, P2B, and the ATP synthase, the kind of marker protein for whether you get fasciculation or not. Because if you look at the localization of these proteins, and this is again DRC12, this is the GFP fusion, I should have indicated that. If you look at rhodomere tone, you see again the DRC12 delocalization, but you also see a complete delocalization of these transmembrane proteins, but in different ways. So in KMRY, really co-localizes with the DRC12. PUP2B, that's not the case. And also with ATP synthase, there is a very clear delocalization, and it's difficult to see what's happening here. And so there's apparently something else going on. So what happens then with the fluidity? And that is kind of the next step. What happens then with the RIFs? So you do a Lardon assay, shown here. So this is the control, benzyl alcohol. You add benzyl alcohol, it goes down. So that means it is more fluid. Well, you see, this is the wild type situation, and this is the rhodomyrtone concentrations, increasing concentrations. So apparently, with rhodomyrtone, you see that the fluidity, overall fluidity in the cell increases. And that is a kind of first effect. And if you look at the microscopy, you see against these clusters that we also saw with the IC12, large concentrations, and they are really very fluid. So you get these large blobs, and they are fluid. But we saw something else with the transmembrane domains, and a few of them kind of co-localized with it. So it might be that there are actually vesicles emerging in this case, your membrane blebs. Oops. So here we have again this ATP synthase localization, and with rhodomyrtone you get those kind of large blobs. So maybe there is membrane invagination. And that is indeed the case. So to show that we used a higher resolution microscopy, SIM microscopy, and we expressed also in the cell just cytosolic GFP to see whether that is replaced. And that is shown here. So you add rhodomyrtone, first of all, and then you see this indeed, this large, you know, clusters and vesicles emerging, and they really are vesicles and not a kind of high accumulation and SIM artifact of the fluorescent label, because here is the GFP, cytoplasm GFP signal, and you see that it's really displaced in these areas. So apparently, rhodomyrtone causes the emergence of large internal membrane vesicles. Now you can also discern it by EM of TEM, as you can see here. So you get these large, huge vesicles in the membrane. And apparently, in some cases, they capture transmembrane domains. So they are very fluid, and there are a lot of proteins that require or that prefer fluid areas. And you see that will then be incorporated. So how is it possible? Because if you look at the structure, I mean, it is definitely, there are hydrophobic groups, but you know, there are also quite some hydrophilic groups. So is it going into the membrane or what happens? So we did a molecular dynamic studies with different concentrations of molecules of rhodomyrtone. This is 1, 2, 3, 4. And you see that the compound does not intercalate into the lipid membrane, but it does pull phospholipids up. And it is not so clear, but if you pull it up, you see that you get a distortion. So the idea is that in this way, this is a larger cluster, this compound kind of pulls it and creates a disorganized region which will facilitate the accumulation of fluid lipids. So this is then the model that we came up. You have here normal membrane, rhodomyrtone will accumulate fluid lipids, the red ones. That will, in fact, reduce the fluidity of the rest of the membrane, and that will therefore displace membranes, peripheral membranes that require this fluid lipids. But what you also see is that in these areas with a lot of fluid lipids, you will attract certain membranes. There are certain membrane proteins that require that profile, and eventually, these proteins will become trapped in the vesicles and therefore cannot function anymore. And that is maybe why it is such a functional and such an efficient antibiotic compound.
10 minutes.
Good. Okay. Well, this is then my last small story, which is not published. The previous has been published very recently. So what about normal antibiotics? This emerged from a study where we used a new dissection method for transmission electron microscopy. So transmission electron microscopy is very useful also to look at the effect of antibiotics, especially if they affect the cell wall or the cell membrane. The big problem is that if you look at E. coli or other rod-shaped bacteria, they have you will find you have to fix a lot of cells, large quantities, and they are located in all orientations. You know, whereas if you want to really look at the effect, you want to be able to know what the pulse is and what the septum, so you need kind of long cells that are completely dissected. So I cannot go into the details, but because of the time, but we were able to make a method where we could fix this bacteria, the rod-shaped bacteria, in one layer, you know, horizontally, and dissect it also horizontally. And this is one of these figures. Now, it might not look impressive, but you know, you can see many cells that are perfectly dissected horizontally. Yeah. And what is so great about this is that now you can do quantitative measurement. You know, you have one whole field where you at least have 50 or 100 cells that are nicely dissected, so you can count what you see. You know, and previously, that was almost impossible. And this is a nice example of a bacillus that you know, is blocked in cell division, so it's a very long cells, and even in that case, you can make some very nice cuts. So we used it, and we looked at as an example, we looked at all kind of antibiotics to see whether we could see anything and whether we could quantify this. Now, I'm not going through all these examples. Adaptomycin, for example, makes here a blob. And you have ampicillin, so you get the cell wall problem. But what we found interesting is that if you look at tetracycline, we found often, you know, large membrane areas, and even also in anhydrotetracycline. And we use this as a kind of negative control, like, okay, you know, if you take tetracycline, that tetracycline blocks protein synthesis, so, you know, binds to the ribosome, and then you would not see anything. And actually, we did see these things, and we could quantify it. So, these are the lesions that we saw with the EM, with the untreated cells, and you see some lesions, some artifacts. With vancomycin, which clearly, you know, affects the cell wall synthesis, you have more lesions that you see here. But we saw also a lot of lesions when we added tetracycline. And many of those lesions were membrane-associated, as you see here. So this is, again, vancomycin. There were some polar problems, some septal, peripheral, you know, not so strange, because it will block beta-glycan synthesis. But in case of tetracycline, you know, the larger fraction was related to the, were somehow membrane associated. So we looked at that more carefully using just a normal dye. So this is the now red stain. And what's interesting is that tetracycline actually will actually also accumulate in membrane and is autofluorescent. So you don't have to label it. You can just also observe it here in the microscope, and that is shown here. So, and this happens if you add tetracycline. This is the tetracycline stain, and you see that, yeah, there is some membrane stain. You see also these large blobs appearing that perfectly co-localize, as you can see here, with NALRED. So apparently tetracycline affects also the cell membrane of bacteria. So, but how important is that? Well, so we looked at the localization of a sensitive membrane protein, MIN-D, and that is shown here. So if you look at the localization of MIN-D and its components, so of MIN-C, and together they form the MIN system that regulates, that prevents mini cell formation and regulates cell division. If you add tetracycline, then within a few minutes, you see that these proteins are completely delocalized. So apparently, the intercalation of tetracycline in the membrane of these bacteria will affect the localization of certain proteins. Now, if you see this, then immediately you have to think like, okay, but this could be the membrane potential. So we looked at another protein, MRB, because the localization of MRB is also so sensitive for dissipation of the membrane potential. But you see that if you have MRB, there is no effect really on its localization after 5 minutes and after 30 minutes. So the effect of tetracycline is not related to the membrane potential, but really with changing the physical parameters of the membrane. Yeah. So this is a new antibacterial activity of tetracycline. And a very effective antibiotic often has different activities. Yeah. And, well, we know that tetracycline affects the ribosome, but maybe it is so effective because it also affects the membrane. And it is therefore very difficult to create resistance against both targets. Okay, so I hope to have shown you the power of bacterial cell biology. And I hope to convey to you that we should really study more in the details of antimicrobial compounds in their activities. Okay, this of course is based on many collaborations. So the adaptomycin started a long time when I was still in Newcastle with Hans-Georg Saal at that time, and at the University of Bonn, Ann Müller did initiated the actual practical work. Tanja Schneider was also involved in that, and Henrik Straal was at that time supervising Anna, and Julia contributed to that as well together with Michaela. Then the, for the rhodomyrtone, that was thanks to Dinapa Seul, who came with a fellowship in my lab from Thailand to study rhodomyrtone. And the last short story is an evolving story together with the Free University of Amsterdam, the medical center, who did all the EM work in the lab of Wilbert Bitte and Jan van Wiering. And again, most of the work was done by Michael Menzel. Thank you for your attention.